All right, now switching gears here, all that is basaloid is not BCC. I think that's what William Shakespeare, or maybe it was J.R.R. Tolkien said. Just kidding. And in any case, though, it's true that just because it's basaloid and in the skin doesn't mean it's basal cell carcinoma. So here's a classic, obvious basal cell carcinoma, one of the first tumors that everyone learns, I think, in pathology. Blue nests of basaloid cells, and they've got nice peripheral palisading, and there's usually this kind of distinct fibrous and myxoid-looking stroma with inflammation sometimes, and clefting around the edge of the nest, all those features that we've learned. Right? So a couple things. Here's another example of basal. Looks great for basal over here, but what's going on here? These big blue pools of mucin. If you're in dermatology, they usually say mucin for this blue stuff. In pathology, we often say myxoid. I use those terms interchangeably. In any case, these blue pools here of irregular size and shape in the middle of an otherwise normal basal cell carcinoma, that's a totally normal, common finding, and it doesn't mean anything, okay? Here's another example, and look at the irregular size and shape of the pools, and very nice peripheral palisading, nice clefting at the edge of the tumor nest with mucin or myxoid stuff present between the basaloid cells and the stroma. Those are classic features of basal cell carcinoma. So what this is called adenoid change. I sign these out personally as basal cell, comma, nodular type, or if there's some other infiltrative area or something else, I'll say that. But I actually don't usually mention adenoid in my report, lest it cause confusion to the treating physician who may wonder, what does that mean? Do I need to do something different? It's just a pattern for pathologists to recognize, to know this looks funny, but it's totally just a normal variant of basal cell carcinoma. There's nothing special clinically about these to my knowledge. The only time I really mention it is if someone had sent me a case in consult. I don't take consult cases anymore, but I used to. And when I did, if someone sent it to me saying, oh, I think it's adenoid cystic carcinoma or adenocarcinoma, then I'd tell them, no, this is just the adenoid pattern of basal cell carcinoma. Now, this looks kind of like a basal cell from low power. It does have some cystic spaces filled with keratin, which basal cell carcinomas often have, actually. But when we look closer, you can see that there's this funny cellular stroma and these round to oval stromal cells. These, if you did a keratin, these would be negative. They're actually stroma, not tumor cells, not epithelial cells. And these rounded stromal cells are pushing into the basaloid nest. That's a classic feature. That's called a papillary mesenchymal body. It's recapitulating what you see at the root of a normal hair follicle, the hair papilla that bulges into the basaloid cells of the hair follicle, the germinative cells. And so this kind of tumor is called a trichoepithelioma, a benign hair follicle tumor, much less common than basal cell carcinoma, but certainly not really rare. You do encounter them. So think if you see this, that's a really good finding. If you see the papillary mesenchymal bodies, recognize that that probably represents a trichoepithelioma, not a basal cell carcinoma. Particularly in patients that are younger or don't have much sun damage, keep hair follicle tumors in mind. Now, in older adults, if they're old and sun damaged, it has to be a perfect trichoepithelioma for me to call it that. Otherwise, I want to be cautious and make sure I'm not missing a basal cell. To me, if I see papillary mesenchymal bodies, it's trichoep. There are some people, though, who believe that basal cell carcinomas can have these. I just have never seen a case that convinced me of that personally. So I'm a little bit of a doubter, but I recognize that other very smart people disagree with me on that. Now, here's one. It's a big nodule. It's composed of many small nests, as we'll see in a minute. But look at this nodule. It's sharply circumscribed, no connection to the epidermis at all. It's sitting down here on its own in the dermis, and it's got its own unique stroma. I mean, go back to here and look. You can see not only the tumor islands, but the stroma around them is got this sharp, distinct cutoff from the background dermis. So that's not the growth pattern of a basal cell, right? A basal cell wouldn't make this perfect marble of tumor that's completely separate from the surrounding dermis and not touching the epidermis at all. That right away should be a clue that this is probably not basal cell carcinoma. That's not how basal cells grow. And then when we look closer, the stroma is cellular. It has a lot more spindled fibroblastic cellularity. And the cells, look what they're doing. Instead of being split and clefted away from the tumor nest, they're hugging, tightly wrapping around the edges of the tumor islands. We don't see any papillary mesenchymal bodies here, but we do see that cellular stroma clinging to the basaloid cells, just like the stroma does. Go look at a normal hair follicle next time you see one. The stroma around the outside of a hair follicle does the same thing. It clings to the outside outside surface of the follicle. We call that stroma the adventitia of the hair follicle. And that's what these tumors are recapitulating, that they're regrowing that kind of stroma. So this is another benign hair follicle tumor called a trichoblastoma. And in my opinion, trichoepithelioma and trichoblastoma, both benign hair follicle tumors that probably exist on a spectrum with one another. The name doesn't matter. Recognizing, though, that it's a benign thing and not basal cell carcinoma potentially matters. So if it looks like basal cell, but you don't see good clefting and mucin, and the stroma looks cellular and is hugging the nest, think of a benign hair follicle neoplasm. And a lot of times these are tricky, and if you're not a dermatopathologist, you may want to consider getting a consult at that point, because I think adnexal tumors, dermpaths, we love them and are fascinated by them. Most other people are like, ugh, please, I don't want to deal with this. But in any case, those are tips to consider a benign hair follicle neoplasm when you see that. And one clue you can use is this, passenger Merkel cells. You can use a CK20 stain, which will show scattered individual cells. You see the whole cytoplasm of these cells is staining, and they're all scattered around throughout this benign hair follicle tumor. I think this was actually a trichofolliculoma, if I recall correctly. But you can see this in a variety of different benign hair follicle tumors, and I find it particularly helpful. There are some other stains people have described, none of which I've personally found that useful. But in any case, I do find the CK20 scattered benign passenger Merkel cells in the midst of the basaloid tumor to be a helpful finding to support a benign thing over a basal cell. Now, what about this? Here's a blue basaloid tumor. I'm not showing you low enough power to see the architecture, but one thing that we can see from here is it's arranged in sheets, and there's really no palisading and clefting at the periphery of the nest, and the nests are not well formed. Again, they're very sheet-like, discohesive in areas, lots of crushed cells and some apoptotic cells, even some necrosis. If we look closer, there's necrosis there. And the tumor cells are molding against one another, and hopefully all these buzzwords right now are ringing the bell in your ear of the diagnosis. And here's another different example just to show you that sometimes the chromatin pattern looks like this, very granular. Other times it looks very fine and smudgy or dusty, salt and pepper if you like. You can use any number of visual cues that you like to describe this. The main thing is that you recognize it when you see it. This is that neuroendocrine pattern of chromatin, and mitoses are usually abundant. So this, of course, is a Merkel cell carcinoma. And to me, the most helpful stain to make this diagnosis is cytokeratin 20, which will show dot-like positivity in many cases, although sometimes the dot-like pattern is not perfect or is only focal. That doesn't matter. If it looks like a Merkel cell and you see CK20 staining, even focally, that is a strong support that what you're dealing with is indeed a Merkel cell carcinoma. There you can do other stains. I usually will just, if it looks great for Merkel and I have CK20 positive, I used to just do that. Now I'll usually add on a TTF1 just to make sure I'm not missing a metastatic small cell from the lung, which I've now seen a few cases of in the skin. It's pretty rare, but it does happen sometimes. Although, of course, those will not usually be CK20 positive. They'll be CK7 positive. So if I do a 20 and it's positive and it looks like a Merkel and TTF's negative, I feel comfortable just calling it Merkel cell carcinoma. Other people would do a broader panel. That's up to you and what your comfort level is. I have a video on that page on Kiko and also on my YouTube channel about how I approach Merkel, so you can check that out if you like. If CK20 doesn't stain, then I expand my panel and do some other stuff to prove it. Sometimes basal cell carcinomas can have some neuroendocrine-looking cytology. So just be aware of that sometimes that does happen, but the architecture, if the architecture looks good for a basal cell, just finding some of this granular chromatin doesn't worry me too much. But if I am worried, I'll do a CK20 to rule that out. I would caution you against doing synaptophysin or chromogranin, because sometimes basal cells can show some neuroendocrine differentiation, and then you're in a real difficult position of how to explain that to the treating physician, because basal versus Merkel is a huge difference in prognosis and treatment. All right, so keep Merkel cell in mind. It's out there and it's sneaky and it's easy to miss. Now here's a basaloid kind of island, and it looks like there's actually a not really good palisading, but there is a little bit of clefting here and there's mitoses. So you could get concerned about basal cell. If the cells were closer together, you could even think a little about Merkel. I've seen this tumor mimic Merkel cell before when it was only a small piece present. But look down here, we got some giant cells. And look over here in a different part of the specimen, we see these sheets of pink ghost or shadow cells that basically are sheets of dead keratinocytes that have left behind the outline of the cell borders and of the nuclei that have all dissolved and gone away. Calcifications are often present. Giant cell reaction is usually robust because these fragments of keratin spill out into the dermis, and the dermis and the immune system do not like free-floating keratin, and they tend to make this robust granulomatous response anytime there's free keratin present. And so, of course, putting these all together, the granulomatous reaction, the sheets of ghost or shadow cells, and then this transition into blue basaloid cells. This is a pyelomatrichoma or pyelomatrixoma, whichever name you like. And mitoses are often abundant in pyelomatrichoma, and that does not in any way worry me for malignancy unless I see severe nuclear atypia or atypical mitotic figures. A bunch of mitoses, I see that all the time in pyelomatrichoma, and it's totally fine. Look for the ghost or shadow cells. That's the key to the diagnosis. And I'll point out that the amounts of these three components can vary from tumor to tumor. Sometimes you have abundant blue basaloid cells, and those are the cases that can really scare people because they see all these blue, round blue cells and all these mitoses, and then they get really worried. Other cases will be just the ghost shadow cells with giant cell reaction, sometimes with a lot of calcification and even ossification, bone formation, with no basaloid cells at all. So the basaloid cells are only there in some cases. Sometimes it's totally burned out and all you've got is this dead stuff and the reaction to it left over. So, and these are, of course, more common in children, but I've seen them even in elderly adults. So they can certainly occur in pretty much any age range. Now, here's something that looks kind of basaloid also. Again, the morphology is not, from low power, not perfect for a basal cell carcinoma. Don't really have good palisading and clefting. And if we go closer, they're pretty ugly nuclei. And there's also all these bubbles, some of which are, they're clear, they're sharply circumscribed, and they indent the nucleus. Some even look like signet rings, mitoses everywhere, including kind of atypical figures. So this is a sebaceous carcinoma. Sometimes sebaceous carcinomas look very basaloid and can kind of resemble basal cell carcinoma or poorly differentiated basaloid squamous cell. And other cases like this is a different case, can look much more squamoid and actually really mimic squamous cell carcinoma. But here you can see at these arrows, definite nice bubbly vacuolated sebacites that are very obvious even on H&E. But over here, if you just gave me this picture, I'd call that squamous cell carcinoma any day of the week. So if you see something that has an ugly, looks like an ugly squame or has overlapping features between basal and squame, especially if you're on the face near the eyes where sebaceous cell carcinomas often occur, I always try to think of sebaceous carcinoma in that setting. Now, the problem is this. Some tumors are obviously sebaceous, but you have a hard time telling are they benign or malignant. Other tumors are obviously malignant, but you have a hard time telling are these vacuoles enough to call it sebaceous, or is that just kind of some artifactual vacuolation in a squame or a basal, which, by the way, I see all the time, unfortunately. So I've written papers about this, and I should know how to do this, but I still struggle with this a lot in practice. I think they're very difficult sometimes to be sure if there's sebaceous differentiation in a carcinoma. Some stains that I've found helpful, but none of which are perfect, is EMA, adipophilin. If you have that, that's actually quite nice. And nuclear staining of factor 13A, which we actually were the first to report and describe in the literature, but only it works if it's clone AC1A1. It's some unusual cross-reactivity that stains the nuclei of both benign and malignant sebacites in the vast majority of cases. But with practice, as I've used it since we published that paper, I've seen it sometimes have patchy staining in squamous cell and other things. So again, the reason we have so many markers is because none of them are perfect. So if I have any doubt, if I see, say I see a case like this, and I'm not sure there's just a little bit of vacuole, sometimes I'll say invasive carcinoma. This could be a basal cell or a poorly differentiated squame or a squame with basaloid features, but there's some vacuolation and I can't exclude sebaceous. The point being there that this is a carcinoma that could potentially behave more aggressively and it should be treated more aggressively clinically, completely excised with negative margins rather than just, curetted or treated with a more conservative procedure. So I do sometimes say that is invasive carcinoma, see comment with the comment that, this is probably just a basal or squame, but sebaceous or other adnexal carcinoma can't be totally excluded. So I certainly have cases where I have to make comments like that and have a kind of hedgy comment, unfortunately. But it gets the job done for patient care. So it seems to be okay. If you have to do that, you have to do it.